Recording, yeah, now we are recording the session. So there are several types to for the data to be stored on your servers. One called structured data and the second one is the unstructured data. The first one is called the structured data, which is certainly you have started using when you deal with database, when you write SQL commands, when you write ADD.NET, when you write queries to build your database, whether to retrieve or to insert certain data into your database. So the structured data, SQL, SQL stands for the structured query language,
And some people I think they call it the standard query language.
No, it's structured query language where you can build insert or delete any kind of data into your database. You write queries to go through the tables, write queries to make several tables, make relations between tables. This is what we call structured data. Okay. The unstructured data is the kind of data which is what we call it, array of bytes. Where we can upload files, images, videos, stuff like that. Okay, so let me recap again. First one is the structured data where you can build structured tables, make relations, create queries. Another one is the unstructured data what deals with zeros and ones or byte of arrays images, certain type of files, PDFs, .doc, and so on. Okay. In the cloud computing, there is a third type of storage called the semi-structured data. This one is a bit like the structured data, but where you can create queries, where you can insert data, where you can delete, and so on. However, the tables are no longer relational. That's why they are called semi-structured. They are not completely structured. Okay. So let's start first using by recapping some of the old session, the last session, which was the web role and worker role, the compute node where you can build your own application on the cloud. So let me recap what's a web role. A web role is for building a web application, a normal web application using any programming language on Windows Azure or on the cloud computing. The worker role is for the back end, of course not for the back, for a background process that can run endure for 1 second and can endure for forever. You can control the time as much as you need for the back end, for the background process. This is more likely used for image processing, for dealing with big data, more likely to use for heavy processing power usage. So the main differences is that the web role is a web application that deals with the user interface, with interactions with the user interface, and the worker role is a background process that has no user interface but can run forever. To make the communication between the connection between the web role and the worker role, the communication between them can be done using two things. One is the service-oriented architecture or the Windows Communication Foundation of Microsoft, WCF. And the second one is using the queue storage of the Windows Azure storage. So let me start explaining you how this is done under the Windows Azure storage and Windows Azure account. After you buy Windows Azure storage account, after that you can build or we can get from it several Windows Azure storage account, which means that each node, whether in the compute node or whether the storage node, run on different hardware resources. The compute node run on the hardware resources and the storage node run on different hardware resources, where you can access the storage node directly, or you can access the storage node through an application hosted on the compute node. So, try to make it easier. If I have an application that deal with a large amount of data, and these amounts need to be partitioned. For example, when you open your computer, you can find several logical drive. Okay, so I can you can do this using the Windows Azure by creating what we call a Windows Azure storage account. You can have several Windows Azure storage account, where in each storage account you can put some data, and in another one put another data. Certainly, you can make some connections. However, let me go through the development right away to help. Yeah, I hope that I can make you understand better how this is deal with how we can deal with the storage using through development. So I'm going now to share my screen. I have to share my desktop. Okay. The first thing they have to do is to. Is to run Visual Studio as administrator. So I have to do something else. Excuse me. I have to do a small thing. Just a second. Yep. Here we go. Okay. To run, the first thing you have to do is to make sure that you are running Windows Azure, your Visual Studio as an administrator. So the first thing is to do is to create a new project. Let's say file. Okay, this is taking too long. After file, new project, cloud. Okay, that is what I'm building right now. Let's call it Windows Azure 4. No problem with that. And I will have to choose what are the types of role previously discussed in the previous session that I will add in my project. So assuming that I use ASP.NET Web role, which is a normal web applications, okay. And the second type that I will have to put is the worker role. Now we are going to put we're going to consume the queue storage to make the connection between the web role and the worker role. Previously, in the last session, I have made this example, but let me go through this very fast. After I create them, I will call them web role one and worker role one, and here we go creating our solution and creating our projects. So, excuse me for this. Yep. This is how you can see that I have several roles. One called web role one, and the second is called worker role one. And I have my third project, which is called Windows Azure 4, where it has a folder and under it the roles that run in the Windows Azure. Okay. So in the web role, I will not go through the configuration and so on. I'll just try to recap them very fast. I will add a new setting where the my application running on the compute node can access the storage account running in the storage node on different hardware resources. Okay. So this is what I'm doing is I'm writing the connection string that I will use to access my storage account on Windows Azure. So for example, we are running on a Windows Azure Storage Emulator, so I'll say OK. After that, I'll go to create a new class. And for example, I'll call class 1. This is mainly used to send the data from a site to another. This is class one is used to send the required data from the web role to the worker role. So public class one, and let's say that I create a private function that will send let's name it private void send message. This, and I will pass a parameter. It's an array of bytes which will contain the message. Whether it's a message, whether it's a string, whether it's an array of bytes, whether it's a, no matter what. Okay. After that, I have to. Yeah, I forgot to initialize my libraries, my namespaces using Microsoft.Windows Azure and using Microsoft.Windows Azure. Dot storage client because I'm dealing with storage.
Okay.
After that, I'm going to start initializing my cloud storage account. If you do remember that I'll have to initialize my cloud storage account and get the connection string from the configuration setting that I have just done. So I'll say cloud storage account named account cloud storage account dot and get it. I can get here the connection string from the configuration setting I have just made, which I will name it data connection string.
After that,
I'll have to define the type of messages or the type of storage that I'm using. In this example, I'm using the CloudQ client. After that, I have to define the queue reference, which I have to give actually the queue a reference. Which I will have to retrieve it in another, in which I'll have to use it to retrieve my message in the worker loop. So I'll say get queue reference, the queue name of the queue ref that I will assign. Okay, let me just to make this easier. Here we go. And get queue ref dot add message. I will add a new message to the queue that I have just created or I've just assigned the reference. Before this, yeah, I have to make sure that I my queue is already existed. Yeah, and that I can here I can say create if not exist to make sure that my data or my queue is already created.
Yeah. Just to adjust that. I don't think there are problems. Yep. Okay. Yeah. Thank you, Tony. Very easy that.
Yep. I think now it's working. Yeah. Let me go through all this again. I've created the cloud storage account, I name it account, and assigned the connection string from the configuration file that I've created, and I name it data connection string. After that, I created a CloudQ client, and assigned a reference or a queue reference, and assigned a name to it, which I called it the queue ref. Let's call this CloudQ, yep. And here I can say this is my queue. Yeah, that might get you a little bit confused. I will explain everything right now. My queue.ph. I said that I've created a cloud queue, okay, from the cloud storage account where I assigned it the connection string name data connection string, and I created for on it the client called CloudQ client. And this queue that I created, I give it the reference called the queue ref. After that, I make sure that I have already created my queue, which is my queue dot create if not exist. After that, just my queue dot add message, and I would have to create a new cloud queue message, and I pass the message to it. Okay, in this line of code, all I have made is that after I created the queue, I added to it a message, a cloud queue message, where I pass the parameter message. And just a simple function. If you have any problem understanding this, you can go through. You can watch me doing the another function at the worker role. Yeah, I've seen that I have a problem with sharing my desktop. Yeah, If you have any problem understanding this function, you can go to my blog, or you can watch me watch the previous what we call it, the previous session about the web role and worker role, or you can even now do the worker role together to retrieve the message. Just I will go to the project named worker role, I create right click, and I will add a new class where I can retrieve my function, my message. Private void retrieve message. I make sure that I'm working with the right using the right libraries by using Microsoft.Windows Azure and using Microsoft.Windows Azure.Storage Client to make sure that I'm working with both the Windows Azure library and Windows Azure Storage Client library. So next step is to create the cloud storage account, dot from configuration setting. Here I didn't assign yet a configuration setting or a connection string to the worker role, so I'll have to go to my Windows Azure 4 project and to the roles, folder role. I'll go to worker role 1, my project worker role 1. I'll go to settings, I'll add new setting. I can call this one on string to make sure that, you don't have to name them the same name. You are free to call them whatever you like. Okay. And the value here is for using Windows Azure Storage Emulator, not for the Windows Azure storage account on the cloud. Okay, I'll save this. I'll go back to my class where I start developing, and in my cloud storage account here, I'll pass it the constraint that I've created. I don't remember. You have to be specific with the capitals and the lowercase of the letters, so you have to watch out. After that, I'll define what type of client that I will work with, whether a queue client, whether a blob client, whether a table client. So after I created the cloud queue client, I will have to choose which queue that I will get from it the message. In this example, I will name it. I don't remember. You have to be specific what the another class in the web role in the queue you defined that its name it's the queue ref. So you have to make sure that you retrieve from the right queue. If you misspell it or if you didn't write it as it is with the lowercase and the uppercase, you will have some problems retrieving the right message. And you may also face a lot of errors. After I define the queue reference that I am looking for, I can now get my message that I'm waiting for. So here we go. I got dot get message, and I got my message. After that, okay. I can even change this a bit. Let's say the private string retrieve message. And in this case I will return the result and I will assign that this will be .toString. Certainly if you're dealing with bytes you can change this to byte and yep, you can change that too, and byte array of bytes which is x, and I don't remember how we deal with this. Log that message, and here we go. That yeah, I remember that we have a problem here. Okay, we can parse the coming message. So let me say that by dot parse. And here we go. I'm not sure if this is working. This is my first time working with bytes. So, blah blah blah. No. So, however, yep. My mistake. Why did I make this very? Yep. now we can make it as return, and we can deal this as a string. Yep, and make this dot to string, and here we go. So let me see what's the problem. The screen isn't shared. Sorry, my mistake. My mistake. I don't know. Something wrong with my laptop. I'm trying to only share the screen. Okay. So, do you have any questions? I don't know how much did you miss. So, is there any question or anything that you would like to ask? This is. In the previous example, we showed to you that I can and now I can send the message from the web role and retrieve it from the worker role using the queue storage. So did you miss anything? I don't know what, from when the screen stopped sharing. So do you any questions? So, is there anyone there? So, apparently, there is no questions. Okay, I'll move on for. Okay, so let me recap what is Windows Azure Queue Storage used for. This is mainly. Windows Azure Queue Storage is mainly used for the to make the communication between the web role and the worker role. Where you run your applications on Windows Azure. The queue storage can only endure for 3 weeks, no longer than that. This is not a durable storage. Is there any question related to this? We can now move on to the next type of storage. So, any questions? Okay. Let's move on to the next type of storage, which is the blob storage. The blob storage is the unstructured type of data that is used for mainly for uploading and downloading any type of files, pictures, and movies. There are several types of blob storage. One called the block blob, and the second one is the page blob. Certainly, you can use the blob without defining a certain type. We can go on with the blob storage directly without using neither block order nor page blob. However, imagine for using the blob storage. Imagine you are using the your laptop or your desktop or your Windows. If you open your Windows, your first thing you will have to define is whether you are using which type of which account. So this is back to our point, which storage account we are using for the development. Okay, after that you will have to define which logical drive you are going to work with, or which folder you're going to save or to retrieve or to write your file on it. Well, it can be a Word document, a picture, any type of that. What I mean is which folder you are going to work with. After that, you can work and put your data in it. The same concept goes for the Windows Azure. If you're talking about Windows Azure, we're talking about first thing is the storage account. After that, it's something similar to the container, what we call the like the folder called container in the Windows Azure. And after that, in each container, you can put any number of blob storage that can reach terabytes per blob. So what are the differences between the different type of blobs? The first step is the block blob. The block blob is mainly used for dividing the whole blob, which means if I do have a blob that's around a certain number of gigabytes or terabytes that I'm going to stream from the cloud provider to the user. if any problem in the internet connection is facing me, I will have to resend the whole packet or the whole blob from again. But using the block blob is mainly used for dividing the blob into small pieces small blocks where it will be easy to transmit. Even if I face any problem during the transmission, the cloud provider will have to resend the only block that faces some problems. For the page blob, the page blob is mainly used for the data for the pages that requires input and output, a lot of input and output from the user. I can take the page and store it in a blob, and when the user go to the specified URL, the page opens from a blob, and here we go, the transmission goes on. So, do you have any problem, any questions about the different types of blob storage? I don't think so. So I don't think there's a lot of the blob storage is very easy to understand. It's very easy to start coding with it or to developing with it. So let us start developing the blob storage and uploading on it, whether any type of storage you would like to upload on it. So I'll have to go back to my Visual Studio. I am sharing with you my screen. Let's forget about the worker role and so on. Let's work only on the web role, where for the default ESPX, where mainly, for example, this is my web form where I will have to upload or download a certain text or certain picture or certain video or any type of that, any kind of this. The first thing is to do is to make sure that I am using the right libraries, which are the Microsoft.WindowsAzure.com, sorry, Microsoft.WindowsAzure, and using Microsoft.WindowsAzure.Storage Client. Okay. The next step is to defining the type of storage that, defining how to deal, the function that I'm going to use. Let's say that this function is designed mainly to upload a certain file or a certain text or a certain image. So I'll call it upload, and here we go. You can pass the parameters that you want in it. Let's say that I'll pass the parameters of bytes, and I'll call it x, array of bytes called x. Here we have to first thing, as we have done in the queue storage, first thing is to create the cloud storage account, which I call it the account, and here we go, cloud storage account, that I will get its connection string from the configuration settings that I have just created in the queue example. I don't remember its name actually. I have to go check in my role. Yeah, I called it data connection string. We're working on default data connection string. After that, as usually, I have to define the type of client that I am working with, account.create cloud client, cloud blob client, because in my example, I will deal with the blob storage. Okay. After that, after I've just created the client, remember when I talked to you about the folder and the container, similarities between the container and the folder. Now under the client I've created, I have to create something similar to the on your desktop, the folder or the logical drive will be created on the Windows Azure, what you call container. So I will have to create a cloud blob container named, for example, here container, and I will assign it to the client by a reference, my container reference. Okay, And each account can have several clients, and each client can have several containers, and each container can have several blocks. Each one of them can have several one, and each one of them can reach terabytes and maybe petabytes. So after I've just assigned the container a reference, I have to make sure that my container is created. So I will say container.create if not exist, to make sure that my container is created. Next step is to work with the Windows Azure permissions. However, let me first go through how, after that I created the container, how the blob is created and how the blob will be uploaded. The simple thing is that I will have to define what I call this cloud blob and name it blob, and I will assign it to the container, my container that I've created, glab blob reference, my blob reference. And certainly my container can have several blobs, and each blob will have a different blob reference. After that, I can upload any type of storage that I would like. Upload byte arrays, upload files, upload from stream, upload text, anything like that. So in this example, I'm uploading a byte array, which is the X I'm just uploading. For the permissions, you know, let me go through this code and explain it again. The first thing is that I have created the account where I have assigned to it the connection string from the configuration setting that I have just created. I've just modified. In the account, I defined a client with the type of client that I'm dealing with. Under the client, I've created several containers, and after that, I have to make sure that my container is created. After that, I work with my blob, so I create a new blob under this container, and I assign to it the reference. And after that, I will upload the required document to it. So, for the permissions, not any user who has this specific URL can access my container. We have to make sure that the users will have only access to a certain. Maybe the blob, only the blob, maybe they can access the container only for to make sure that it exists. Maybe they cannot access anything. If they go to the website, you will not give them the permission to access the storage or your storage. Why the blob storage is used for make a user access any type of storage? Because blob storage can be used for uploading images, and maybe your website is a public one, so anyone can access your storage depending on your demands and your needs. So let me go for variable permissions and get permissions. And now I have to specify the permissions of public access, who will have the authority, the public access, what he will be able to see. So in this example, I will allow him to see the blob storage itself. After that, I'll have to assign the permissions made to the container itself. So I'll say container.set permissions, and I'll pass it the permissions that I have just created. So far we just have done a function that created the account, client, the container, assigned the permissions to the container, and uploaded a blob. Let's go for example for another function that downloads certain data from the blob storage. Simply, I will do this one very fast. Cloud storage account dot from configuration setting. I have to pass it the data connection string. I define which type of storage that I'm working with, that I'm willing to work with. Defining which container that I will need to access it, which is in this case is my container ref, After that, I will see what type of. So I'll have to go to my blob that I want to access, which is my blob ref. After that, I can tell to download byte array, which is my byte array. So in these two functions, one is simply to upload the required array of bytes, and the second one is to download them. You can use them to whether to upload the certain document or to download a certain document. Certainly, we'll have the storage account. If you face any errors during the development, there's a class called the storage error. Storage errors to handle the errors that to handle the exception of errors or the exception of storage that you might face. So, any questions so far? Anyone has any questions? So let us go to the third type of storage, which is the table storage. The table storage is the semi-structured data on this Azure where I can develop and store up tables that can reach terabytes and gigabytes. On Windows Azure using the semi-structured data. The semi-structured data is different than the structured data in many ways. The first one is that the structured data in Windows Azure is limited to 150 gigabytes, and the unstructured, the semi-structured data can reach terabytes on Windows Azure. The structured data is relational tables using primary key and foreign key and queries and so on. The same concept goes for the table, the semi-structured or the table storage with queries and insert and delete and so on. However, they are not relation, which means that you cannot go from one table to another in the Windows Azure table storage. In the structured data or the SQL Azure, you can have queries that can get a lot of number of entities or and so on. However, there's some limitation in Windows Azure Table Storage. You can get around 1,000. After that, we'll have to require a continuation token so we can retrieve all the other entities from the Windows Azure storage from the Windows Azure Table Storage. There are also some differences in the Windows Azure prices. For the Windows Azure Table Storage prices, the prices for the Windows Azure Table Storage are so low. It's somehow cheap. You pay around 10 cents for each giga plus the number of transactions you are facing. Again, if you are facing for around 10 for each 10,000 transactions made on your storage, you will have to pay 1 cent. However, for the table, for the structured data, or for the SQL Azure or data, Windows Azure SQL database, you will have to pay, I think, minimum $10 for each giga. Maybe there are new offers now for the 100 megabyte SQL Azure, but I'm not aware of it. So, back to the code. How to develop a Windows Azure table storage. Very simple. I have just deleted the code I have just written now, and here we go. I'll delete this one too. Okay, all you have to do is mainly you have to deal with, in my opinion, two main classes. One called entity, and the second one is called context. make sure that you are always using the right namespaces. And also in the entity and in the context, you have to make sure that you are always working with the right thing. In the entity, you have to inherit from the table service entity, and in the context, you also have to inherit from the table service context. The table service entity, this is where you define what each entity in the Windows Azure table storage will contain. So let me explain a little bit how the entities and the storage go in Windows Azure Table Storage. The table storage in Windows Azure is going through, you can is scalable through along the infrastructure from Windows Azure. So to easily manage and to easily get data from it, they divided this table storage into what we call partition. Yeah, for example, this is a partition of group A, this is a partition of group B, this is a partition of group C, where each group have a lot of common things. To define each group, we'll have to use something called a partition key. So we divide the whole table storage into some partitions, into a number of partitions. Each partition will have its own partition key. After that, to define each partition will have a lot of entities. To define the entity you are looking for, you will have to each entity will have to have something unique that defines it from the other entities, which we call a row key. So while you're having the row key and the partition key, you can access any entity in a specified table storage. Let's go through some development and maybe we'll get this closer to you. So here I will define the data type that I want to store in the entity in the table storage. So I'll say, for example, public string email. I'll get certainly setters and getters and public string name. Setters and getters. After that, I'll create my constructor, which is I call entity. Well, I pass with the partition key and the email or the row key, which I will define later on. They don't have to be the same like the data types that are in the entity itself. I can say that the partition key the partition key is the partition key that I have here, that I have that's are in the parameter, and the row key, which is the row key in the parameter. Okay. So any questions so far? Do you face any problem with that? Yeah, I've just seen that my screen is no longer shared. Let's use this. Yeah, here we are. We're back for doing this. For using, you can see my desktop right away. After that, in my entity, I've created the entity class where I put it into the type of attributes that I'm looking for, the constructor where we'll have to pass the parameters in it. Okay, let's go for the next one, which is the context. The context, which where we'll have a lot of where it will contain a lot of the code that will require to work with the tables. So let's first go for the context for the constructor. Context. I'll pass to it the string with address of the my Windows Azure and storage client. This is what defines storage credentials. This is what defines my storage account, my stable. How can I access it? Its base address, its URL, and its the credential that I have, so I can easily access it. So. After that, I will go to the I will create a certain function that will pass for me the what we call the data service context. Just 1 second, I'm facing some problems. Yep. Here we go. Yeah, prior. I said here we're looking for to pass the table service context that I'll have to deal with during my development, whether to insert or to retrieve some data from the Windows Azure table storage. So public table service context. And I'll create get service context. And all it has to do here is to make sure, that I got a table service context from the storage account that I'm creating to deal with the data and my table storage. So I can say return cloud storage account dot from configuration settings. I don't have to say this to it. I have previously explained this, so I'm quite sure you remember this. Cloud table dot get data service context, and here we go. Next step is to add users into the table that I'm looking for. So public void add users. Here we go. The first thing is to make sure that I have created the table. So I will say cloud storage account dot from configuration setting. Yeah, I'll have to repeat this several times. That I can do this using one function that will return us the account to me. But here we go. That from configuration settings dot create table client dot create table if not exists. Excuse me for this. Yep. And that pass table name. So now in this line I'm sure that the class have been created. Let's go for the next step that I will have. We can take this as I'm doing a small example. This one I can put here, or I can call function and say variable x equals table service context. So it would get the service context that I have just the function that I have just created, and I can after that add object in the specified table that I created in a specific table, and I pass to it the entity that I am looking for. So I can say here new entity, and the entity will have to pass its partition key or row key, so I will have to require this from other spaces. For example, I will take it from here as a parameters. Yep. Partition key and row key. Let's assume that our user will required, as we previously mentioned. Yep, email and a name, so I'll have to take them from here too. I'm just building an example. It depends on your needs. So I'm just showing you how this works. Yep. This one. Yeah. This means that the first one is the name or the email defined in the entity will take the email or the name defined in the parameter here. And here we go. I'm just added new user, and here we go. Save changes with retries to make sure that my data is saved and stored in Windows Azure storage. So Let's do a last function that retrieve a certain user from the table with a specified partition key and row key. Remember that I cannot get a user from the table storage without having its own partition key and storage key. I'll say public void retrieve. Yep, I'll pass to it the string, the partition key and the row key. Okay, let's say string partition key and string row key. Here we go. I'll have to return the specified entity that I have created. Okay, so I'll have to return, yeah, from the list of the table store, the data table service context that I'm getting from I'm just trying to get along with my code. Query entity. So, in this example, in the get service context dot create query entity, for example, I have created the service context that I need, and I created a query with the required parameters entity in the specified table with its own table name, called table name. After that, I will choose which parameter that I work with. The equal, for example, I can, yani, in this table, I have to define which partition that I would work with. So e dot partition key equal the partition key equal for the partition key that I just passed, and e dot row key equal the row key that I just got it in the parameters. So that I will select the e and I'll pass it as first row default. We can do this for the retrieving the all users in the specified partitions. So, but certainly will not get the return will not be a certain one entity. It will be a cloud query of the specified entity, of a specified object called entity. So now I've just went with you through the three type of storage. One. The one is the queue storage, the second one is the blob storage, and the third one is the table storage. So if you need anything, you can go to my blog here. I send you right now .wordpress.com. This is my blog, and you can find all the related examples and the predefined functions in it. So if you need anything, please contact me. Don't hesitate to contact me, and let me. And waiting your feedback. Thank you.